passion-driven life. A good theme. And we just heard a motivational speaker, Mr. Townsend. Here he is speaking to a group. And look who we've got here. Two lovelies.
Hi.
Two people that don't have boundaries. My kind of people. People I can control. No boundary types.
We are boundary setters.
Like this can only go
right
now.
We're in the middle of talking right now, so you'll have to.
Nice to be with you, young ladies here.
Oh, you too, Joe.
Nice to teach you how to react to an alpha male like me.
Yeah, we're in the middle of a conversation, so why don't you go this way and then come back?
Okay.
Ciao.
Ciao.
And you want to talk about burnout with a passion, although I'm still extremely passionate.
Facility in Dunwoody, Georgia. Now, I'm not from Georgia, y'all. Can you tell from my accent? It's really funny. I used to live in England with my wife, and we used to do these speaking arrangements. And everybody said, "Where are you from?" I said, "I'm from Scotland. Can't you tell?" I guess they didn't understand the New Jersey accent. Anyway, I want to welcome you. Today is a very exciting day because passion, let me read to you guys. Does anybody know the real definition of passion? Passion, let me read it for you. It's a powerful and compelling emotion. It's a strong feeling and desire. It's about love, fondness or desire, an outburst of strong emotion and feeling. Now, why did the founder of Passion Driven Life pick the name Passion? Because we live in dangerous times right now. We live in times that are troubling. Most Americans feel anxious, insecure. So my message is going to be about hope today. And my message is going to be about how do we solve the problem of the healthcare crisis? Because truly, our medical system has failed us. Our medical system has let us down. We are the strongest country in the world. We are the most innovative, the most industrious country in the world. And we are, as Americans, we're fighters, we're creative, and we have the ability to solve problems. Because I feel that Americans are critical thinkers. But right now, we're being taught, and we're given a message by the media of hopelessness. I want to bring the media to accountability and take responsibility for their negative message. So we need to fight as Americans because right now we're being told lies. And when you have lies, it brings fear. And when there's fear, there's no action. When there's no action, nothing happens. Now, when I started working with the vision of Progressive Medical, my concept was to put patient first. We got some great doctors. I can honestly say that the majority of doctors in our country truly become doctors because they want to help heal people. But I'm going to tell you something. Doctors do not heal patients. You can heal yourself. God is the only one that can heal you. Doctors are called to tell patients and show them what to do. Does anybody know what doctor means in Latin? Anybody take Latin?
Teacher.
Doctor is docere. Docere means teacher. Now let's be honest. When's the last time you've been to a doctor? Because it's not the doctor's fault, it's the system. Our system is based on what? See a patient for 3.8 minutes, write a prescription, and you're out the door. Now, I'm not sure if you had that experience, but I know a lot of my patients have. We need to change the system and allow the doctor to spend more quality time. Okay, it's quality time, so the doctor can teach you why you have this specific disease. But now, not to pick on the doctors, the reality is we live in an instant gratification system. Now, do any of you know that we are the only country next to New Zealand that advertises pharmaceuticals on television. Did you know that? Do you guys ever watch those commercials and they're dancing and they're smiling and they say, take the purple pill? Nobody here needs the purple pill.
See this way? This way?
You guys watch the movie The Matrix? Take the pill.
It's very slow.
And you'll be able to see the reality.
You can move it up and down, too.
But because the American Medical Association reported recently that 60% of all prescriptions prescribed by the primary care doctor are not necessary. That's the American Medical Association. So why do you think a doctor gives you that medication? Is it because he's stupid? No. It's a business. If you go to the doctor because you watch the commercial and they're dancing and they're smiling, and you go, Dr. Jones, I want that purple pill. If Dr. Jones doesn't give you the purple pill, where are you going to go? You're going to Dr. Smith. And Dr. Smith will write you a prescription. This is a true story. My friend is a primary care physician, very, very knowledgeable doctor. Patient walks in, sniffly nose, he has the flu, he's not feeling good. My friend does a CBC on him, he can do the testing right there. He finds out he has a virus. He says to the patient, go home and rest. I want you to take 30 milligrams of zinc. I want you to take 500 to 1,000 milligrams of vitamin C. Take some vitamin D, you'll be fine. The patient says, doctor, I need the prescription. He goes, no, you don't have a bacteria infection. He goes, I want an antibiotic. I need it. It's going to help me get well. He goes, no, you don't need the Z-Pak. Not only did the patient go across the street, get a Z-Pak, which did absolutely nothing for his situation, because it's a virus, that patient filed a complaint against my friend at the medical board. My friend got a letter. He had to hire an attorney. My friend now gives antibiotics when they don't need it. Can you blame him? Okay? He's got to go to work for me, you're right. So the point I'm trying to make, it's actually a combination of problems. It's not only the physician, it's the system. Now, in 1776, there was a very, very well-known doctor by the name of Benjamin Rush, M.D. And in about 10 minutes to 15 minutes, I'm going to introduce a former congressman. I'm not going to say ex-congressman because he told me that that's called an ex-con. There's no ex-cons in Congress. But anyway, in 1776, one of my heroes was Benjamin Rush, M.D. Anybody heard of Benjamin Rush? Benjamin Rush was the only medical doctor to sign the Declaration of Independence. He was the only physician that took care of George Washington. He was forward-thinking. He had memoirs about how he treated patients using herbs, natural medicine, homeopathy, which was not even really at the beginning stages. Actually, homeopathy started in Germany by Samuel Hahnemann. So he knew that he was a progressive doctor. He wrote in his memoirs, unless we put medical freedom into the Constitution, a time will come when medicine will organize into an undercover dictatorship. To restrict the art of healing to one class of men and deny equal privileges to others will be called the Bastille of medical science. Bastille is French for prison. All such laws are un-American and despotic and not have a place in our republic. Therefore, the Constitution should make special provisions for medical freedom as well as religious freedom. Now, this man had a vision. This man knew that the sinfulness, the sinful nature of man, we would corrupt medicine. Because the truth of medicine is a business. Unfortunately, we do not have medical freedom into the Constitution. So what do we need to do? We need grassroots movement. We need to educate our patients how to take care of themselves, how to prevent. Why is it during this healthcare debate, no one has talked about wellness, healthcare, prevention? The British Lancet, which is the equivalent to the American Journal of Medicine, New England Journal of Medicine, reported that there's five key causes for cancer. Now, cancer is big business in our country. I'm sorry to tell you that 1 in 2.5 Americans are going to get cancer. That's sad. In 1972, President Nixon declared war on cancer, and 1 in 7 Americans got cancer in 1972. He allocated $500 million for research. Now, I want to ask you something. If you give me $500 million, I'm going to get you some answers. Do we have any more answers of what causes cancer in our country? If you go to an oncologist, they're going to tell you, ask an oncologist, hey, doctor, what causes cancer? He's going to say, does it really matter? Here's your chemo. Here's your radiation. Here's your surgery appointment. Now, I'm not saying that there isn't a place and a time for surgical intervention. I'm not saying there's not a place and a time for chemo. However, we believe that we must build our immune system up that God gave us first, talk about detoxification, do some testing that's specific for you, then we'll talk about chemo, radiation at lower dosages. That's the most responsible thing to do. Why is it then that 12% of people that get cancer that do traditional medicine, according, by the way, to the American Medical Association, will survive? Those are not very good odds. You're better off sometimes doing absolutely nothing. I don't recommend that, by the way, because there's so many... I mean, there have been studies on this. People inside do nothing actually live the exact same amount of time that people do traditional medicine. We need an integrative approach. This is my message. Integrate the best modalities. You have acupuncture, homeopathy, naturopathy, osteopathy, chiropractic care. All of these therapies have validity. All of these therapies are scientifically proven to help you. Is one therapy going to help cure you? Absolutely not. There's no way. If any doctor tells you that they're going to cure you with one therapy, you need to find another doctor. That means he only has one bag of tricks. Or one trick in his bag. Okay. So let's talk a little more about the mitochondria. First of all, does anybody know what the mitochondria is? Okay. Let's go back to our science days. The mitochondria is the spark plug of the cell. If you drive a car and the car has no spark plug, you know what's going to happen? The car is going to sputter. The car is going to lose its ability to accelerate. So when your mitochondria is congested, when your mitochondria does not have the proper nutrition, you're going to sputter. You're going to have more fatigue. You're going to have the potential for more depression. You're going to have more symptoms. Now, by the way, does anybody know what symptoms really mean? Something's wrong.
That's right. Just relax.
In traditional allopathic medicine, and by the way, I hate the word traditional. What's traditional about drugs? My gosh, I read in the Bible that they were using frankincense and myrrh over 2,000 years ago. That is the traditional medicine. Allopathic medicine, to me, is brand new. It's only been around for 200 years. Okay? Getting back to the symptoms. Symptoms are a sign that the body is out of homeostasis. Homeostasis is everything is in balance internally, regardless of external factors. What does that mean? If your average temperature is 98.6, is it going to really change if it's outside 60 degrees? No, because your body knows how to compensate internally. But if your temperature is 96.2, that's a sign that something's wrong. If your temperature is 100 degrees, that's a sign that your body's killing an infection, which is a good sign, by the way. Nobody likes symptoms. Who likes to have a headache? Nobody does. Who likes to have numbness and tingling? Sore elbow, sore knee, sore back? Nobody does. Okay? But we cannot irresponsibly treat symptoms only because we suppress disease. I want you to listen to that again. When you treat symptoms alone, you will suppress a disease. If you have a digestive problem and you decide to take the purple pill, okay, the purple pill was designed for only 30-day usage. Why? It's actually a pro-pump inhibitor. It blocks your hydrochloric acid. When you block your hydrochloric acid, you develop a protein deficiency. When you get a protein deficiency, you don't have amino acids. When you don't have amino acids, guess what? They are the building blocks of the body. They're called essential amino acids. It's called essentially fatty acids, essential minerals. I've never heard of essential Tylenol. I've never heard of essential Prozac. Yet, Americans are taking these drugs. Last year, 50,000 Americans died from methamphetamine toxicity. Did you hear that? Tylenol. 50,000 Americans, I'm going to tell you why. A lot of Americans take Tylenol because of pain. They go to a pain doctor, they take codeine with Tylenol. They don't know what's in there. They get double the dosage, triple the dosage. They go into liver failure. If you know anybody here that has liver toxicity, the best thing you can do, alpha-lipoic acid, 600 milligrams, 3 times daily. Alpha-lipoic acid is made from nutrients. It's actually a derivative from spinach. It actually helps you develop glutathione, which is 3 amino acids. Glutathione has been shown through research, the highest level of glutathione, you will live the longest. It's powerful stuff. It's a powerful, powerful antioxidant. Good, you're taking it. Okay. So the mitochondria is very, very important. Okay, good question. How much spinach did you have for alpha-lipoic acid in high levels? To get 100 milligrams, you only need about 10 pounds. That's why the spinach today, there's a question about how much spinach you need to have. Too much. You're not going to eat it. You have to have as much as Popeye. The spinach today has about 1 to 2% nutrients than it did 50 years ago. Even if it's organic. Why? Because our soil has been irresponsibly depleted of trace minerals. Minerals are the spark plugs of life. Without minerals, the body cannot make enzymes, cannot make vitamins, cannot make hormones. They're called cofactors. Okay? So that's why we recommend alpha-lipoic acid. You can get it in any health food store. The mitochondria is found in every cell, but specifically abundant in your muscle, of the heart, the kidney, and the brain. Now, when you have, when you're lacking mitochondria, your brain function has become very, very foggy. Your cognition, your memory, is not as sharp. Let's understand something. We have, by the way, does anybody know what the most important organ of the body is? That's close. I'm going to have to say, from my professional opinion and research, the brain. If the brain is not running sharp, see, the brain is only less than about 3 pounds. It's very, very small. Unfortunately, our brain controls all of our actions of our hormones, our muscles, our organs. So you have to keep the brain sharp. Now, what causes brain issues? The mitochondria is not functioning properly. Okay. According to Professor Enzo Mazzoli, adults possess 10 million, did you hear this? 10 million billion mitochondria, which corresponds to approximately 10% of the body weight. That's amazing, amazing statistics. So 10% of your body is the mitochondria. Now, Jeffrey Bland, who's one of the leaders in functional medicine, actually hypothesized that the mitochondria was a cell on its own. But because of fusion, the mitochondria went into the cell. And what's happening now because of toxicity, because of disease, and because your vessels are leaky, it's called leaky vessels, because of lack of nutrients and, right the middle there, and chemicals, that the mitochondria is not functioning properly. Okay, so what are you doing about the mitochondria?
Sorry.
Okay. The mitochondria is damaged because of what? Lack of exercise. Now, let's be honest. Does everybody exercise here consistently? Exercise is one of the best ways to re-energize.
Thank you.
Re-stimulate. But it's exercise consistently. You don't have to become a bodybuilder. You don't have to run a marathon. As a matter of fact, I'm going to make a very strong statement here. Running excessively is not the answer to wellness. Running excessively, and I read an article 6 months ago, there was a runner that just documented his 1 millionth mile of his life. This guy runs about 300 miles a week, which is insane. During his interview, He's got two knee replacements, one hip replacement. His ankle's broken 12 times. He is emaciated, but he ran his million miles. Most runners do not live long. Okay? Everybody thinks a runner is healthy. Is that better? Everybody thinks a runner's healthy, but they're not. They burn the body at such high capacity, they actually burn the magnesium levels. Magnesium is the most important mineral. If you are not taking magnesium, you're missing an important key to health and wellness. Now, why is cardiovascular disease the number two killer in our country? We've got all the best statin drugs in the world.
Around here, you might catch
my Isn't cholesterol the cause of heart disease? That's what they want you to think. Cholesterol is one component.
No, I'll try to get her.
The number one cause of heart disease is inflammation. Number one. Something called C-reactive protein, homocysteine levels, fibrinogen levels. These inflammatory markers will cause your heart to function suboptimally. We need to control inflammation. Number two, it's infections. If you do not find a physician to look for infections, disease will run rampant. What kind of infection are we talking about? We're talking about viruses. We're talking about mycoplasma, bacteria infections. Okay. There's a lot of good functional tests to look for that. Number three, insulin. You've all heard of insulin resistance. Insulin, believe it or not, if you have more than one teaspoon of sugar in your body is completely out of balance. I read a report from Dr. Roundtree, who's a physician out of Colorado. 10 years ago, 10% of all diagnosed type 2 diabetes, which by the way is adult onset, were children. Now, first of all, I just said adult onset. What are children doing with type 2 diabetes when they're children? Okay. The report came out last year. Guess how many children are part of the newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes? 42%. Now, does that mean that our genetics have changed? Does that mean that something happened from one generation to the next? I beg to differ. It's an environmental dietary. The number one ingredient that's changed the last 20 years, high fructose corn syrup. Number one. When children have high fructose corn syrup, the bloodstream cannot handle an influx of sugar. Automatically, your pancreas will release insulin because it's doing its job, and then you burn out the pancreas. It is a shame that our children are going to become more sick than we are. We've got to change this system. Lack of exercise. Poor nutrition. Most of us live in a very fast-paced society. We want instant gratification. We want to drive into McDonald's and Burger King and all these fast food places. And do you really think they care about the quality of the food? Now, you're not going to get sick by eating at one time. But when you have this food every single day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks out of the year, 20 years later, you become sick. Anybody watch the movie Super Size Me? It's a very powerful, powerful documentary. That tells you, in addition to the food industry being in trouble, do you guys remember the tobacco industry? Does anybody remember C. Everett Koop? I respect C. Everett Koop. He was the Surgeon General during the Ronald Reagan era. He took on the tobacco industry. But what's wrong about C. Everett Koop? He had the guts. But you know what? The tobacco industry is so powerful. Guess what they did? They purchased RJR Nabisco. Anybody know who that is? Largest food manufacturer. They hired PhD chemists to find chemicals so you can get hooked on that French fry. Let's be honest. Can you stop at one McDonald's French fry? No way. There's a chemical there that enhances your taste buds. They affect your neurotransmitters, and they're synthetic. If you eat dead food, you will become must have live, nutritious food. That's how our maker designed us. Okay? So poor nutrition, poor hydration. The reality is most Americans are dehydrated. Most Americans are not getting the intracellular hydration. Intracellular hydration means that the fluids are in your cell. Why is that? Back in 2004, Dr. Marsha Black did a study in northern Georgia. She found out that the tadpoles were not becoming frogs. All the mosquito fish and fish were dying in northern Georgian lakes. Would you like to know why? Antidepressants were in the lakes. Prozac, Wellbutrin, Paxil. Now, how did they get into the lakes? Do you think somebody dumped them? No, urine. When you take a medication, less than 20 to 25% of the medication is absorbed by the body. The rest of it is excreted from your urine. When you urinate, all your medications go into the water supply system and they chlorinate it to make it look clear. They can't filter it. The only water municipality in the country that is the best is Orange County. Orange County spent billions of dollars. They have a 10-system process. You know, people say that New York water is the best. It's not the best. You think it's the best. It's not. Orange County of California is the best water because they have a 10 process. They reverse osmosis. They ozonate it. Ozone is the most powerful way to clean water. They laser it. They put minerals back in. It's the best. The rest of the water is garbage. If you're taking a bath without a filter, you're getting medicine. Fox News did an expose. 43 water municipalities were loaded with medications. So if you think you're medication-free, but yet you take a bath and wash your hands, you're not medication-free. You're getting medications in the water. You must protect yourself and your family. This is serious, serious business. Over 115 million Americans, according to the CDC, have taken antidepressants in the last 12 months. Could you imagine that? 115 million. Now, I'm not saying depression's not real. Depression's real. But no doctors get into the root cause. Dr. Kenneth Cooper. You guys ever heard of Kenneth Cooper? Kenneth Cooper is a research physician out of Dallas, Texas. He started the Cooper Institute in the 1960s. He did a double-blind study with exercise and antidepressants. And guess which one won? Exercise. Exercise releases your endorphins, helps your neurotransmitters, with the little chemical communicators of the body, so you feel good. Okay? Number four. Would you believe that negative emotions dramatically affect the mitochondrial function? There's no doubt that every single American has problems. Every single American has troubled times. But it's how you deal with those troubled times. If you ask people, you know, it was interesting. I was in England over the summer. The oldest man at 112 passed away. And I heard his interview. He actually had very, very poor dietary habits. But you know what? He used humor. He had very strong family commitment. Very strong faith. So you can do all these wonderful things. You can detox. You can remineralize. You can take your organic foods. But if you are a negative person, and I'm not talking about being constantly happy and delusional and not living reality, but it's how you deal with that stress. No one here can get away with stress. As a matter of fact, I believe that troubling times strengthen us. I believe in a troubled time that real leaders will come up and they will help push us through. Because without troubled times, how else is God going to move us? How else are we going to be able to, if everything was utopia, you know what? We become spoiled. We are spoiled in this country. I challenge all of you to go to Haiti and see what they have in Haiti. Go to a third world country, and I can tell you right now, you will kiss the ground that you live on. We are spoiled in the United States, and we want everything hanging on a silver platter. And we must step up and take responsibility as opposed to just... And when it comes to medicine, everybody thinks the doctor's going to hear them. We put all the blame on the doctor. And I challenge the patients to take responsibility for themselves. Okay, never on emotions. Next one. Genetics. You know, I'm not trying to say genetics, but 20% of disease definitely has a genetic component. We can't be unrealistic about that. However, just because your mother, just because your father or grandfather had diabetes doesn't mean you're going to get it. If you fall into that trap, you will get it. But I will say one thing. Look at your family gene pool. If there's something questionable, be proactive. If diabetes runs in your family, be proactive. Find out every tool available to you, and you will prevent that disease, or at least have it down the road, and you can handle it better. Heavy metal toxicity. Anybody hear of heavy metals? Lead, mercury, arsenic, aluminum, cadmium. You must be evaluated. The best way to be evaluated for heavy metals is a tissue mineral analysis, which is a hair analysis, or a urine test. A blood test is not the best way to determine that. I'm going to tell you why. If you're exposed to mercury, say 15 years ago, the way your body works is you digest that mercury, your body tries to get rid of it, it only lasts in the blood stream for 30 to 35 days. You're either going to excrete it or you're going to store it in the tissue. So we must challenge your body, or we measure it from a hair analysis. Co-infections. Co-infections are viruses, bacteria, fungus, microbes. If you have an infection, it's going to affect your mitochondria. All right, so what do we do about the mitochondria? Hang on a second, it's coming up.
Running after me.
Uh-oh. I lost my column. Okay, so what do I do about the mitochondria? There are 5 to 6 different things that you can do for the mitochondria. Number one, there's a nutrient called L-carnitine. Anybody know L-carnitine? L-carnitine is an amino acid. You probably get amino acids from proteins, good source proteins. Now, for those of you that are vegetarians or vegans, I believe that's a great diet for cleansing. I do not believe that everybody should be on a vegan diet long term. You need some protein. But the problem is, in America, we have too much protein. We have protein that is inorganic, full of synthetic hormones, full of chemicals, and it's unhealthy. But carnitine is critically important for the mitochondria. I usually recommend a minimum of 500 milligrams a day of carnitine. Okay? Some more, some less. Number two, CoQ10. CoQ10 is a nutrient. It's not a vitamin, it's not a mineral. It's actually part of the Krebs cycle. Most cells have CoQ10. It's ubiquitin. It means it's in every cell. The best form of CoQ10 is called ubiquinol. But Dr. Sears, which I've quoted before, Dr. Sears is an integrative physician down at West Palm Beach. He's done numerous studies with a Japanese physician, and ubiquinol is the best form. That's the form I use. We only need 100 milligrams to 400 milligrams. Very, very powerful. Number two, something called NADH. NADH is part of the Krebs cycle. 5 milligrams. Very important. We talked about exercise, which is also important. I'm also going to tell you that alpha-lipoic acid, is that really alpha-lipoic acid? Very, very important nutrient. It's good for your insulin. It's good for your liver. It's a free radical scavenger. One of the original physicians that researched alpha-lipoic acid, he kind of stumbled onto it back in the 1970s. This physician worked in Cleveland. He was doing a residency. And the chief resident found out that he did not experience any of his patients dying. So part of his program was he had to experience someone dying. So they brought him in there, and they gave 2 patients with liver disease. One had Tylenol toxicity, the other one had mushroom poison. So they took him across, and they basically said to him, these are your patients, I want you to document what's happening in the history of their death for the next 72 hours. So because he was a PhD first, he was a research scientist, he called the NIH and said, listen, what are you guys researching for liver disease? One of the physicians said, listen, we've got some alpha-lipoic acid here. I don't even know what it's for. The Russians and Germans are doing the research. So what did he do? They shipped it over to him. He injected 600 milligrams of the alpha-lipoic acid the patient, not only did they not die, but their liver toxicity reversed for 7 days. Now, you can imagine how excited he was. The problem is the hospital he worked in, the number one hospital for liver transplants, they were not happy. Not happy at all. You know, liver transplant costs $100,000. So, alpha-lipoic acid is a very, very important nutrient. Okay, next nutrient for the mitochondria, magnesium. Magnesium, and everybody's totally different. How many of you general, at least 400 milligrams. There's several forms of magnesium. Magnesium citrate, but I like to use magnesium chloride. Magnesium chloride is the most absorbable. We have a topical magnesium that we can use, that we use also. It's very, very effective. Last nutrient, and I'm going to stop talking about nutrients, and we're going to go talking about some other things. There's a substance called resveratrol. Okay. Resveratrol is a powerful, powerful antioxidant. Resveratrol was actually researched by John Hopkins. They actually purchased a laboratory to do the research, because now they find out when you take resveratrol, there's a tremendous amount of longevity at the DNA level. Very, very important, helping the mitochondria. So if you add all of these principles, you incorporate detoxification with infrared saunas, ionic foot baths, positive thoughts, sleeping effectively. Sleep is probably one of the major contributors to disease. Because when you do not sleep, the body cannot rest, the body cannot rejuvenate. Now everybody has different sleeping needs. I'm not going to tell you you need 8 hours. I will say that the magic number as we get older is about 5.5 to 6.5 hours. If you're sleeping more than 8 hours, that's a problem. Too much sleep can be detrimental to your health. So find a balance. In addition, we've been researching that electromagnetic frequencies, they're called EMFs, are very detrimental to the body. Now, what's that? Cell phones, television, computers next to your brain. If you have a television in your bedroom, unplug it when you go to bed. If you sleep next to an alarm clock, move that alarm clock to the floor. I met a physician from Berkeley University. Met him 10 years ago at a presentation. He came up to me, he asked me a question about the sauna. He said, how much EMFs are in your sauna? I didn't have the answer. I go, what's your interest? He goes, well, I'm a brain tumor survivor. I go, really? How did you get a brain tumor? He said, really? I'll tell you how. My alarm clock. He was a brilliant guy, by the way. He had 2 PhDs in biochemistry. He was an electrophysicist. He actually measured every electronic device in his house. And because... because this electricity affected his brain chemistry, that caused a brain tumor to start. Now, we know that there's many, many neurologists that believe that aspartame, electromagnetic frequency, all of these synthetic materials contribute to brain cancer. So, the key here is to have a balanced approach.
No, I can get
them. So the balance approach, getting back to the healthcare price, I'm going to tie up all in a couple minutes. The key to our healthcare crisis and the way you can get involved is by contacting your local representative and say, listen, why are we not talking about wellness? Why are we not talking about prevention? Why are we not talking about empowering our doctors to learn more? Do you know that the most medical doctors have less than 10 hours of nutrition in school? Why is that? It's because of the system. We need to make them responsible, because the key is wellness and prevention. We've got to get away from the disease model. Okay. I want to introduce, and I'll take questions now, I want to introduce a very good friend of mine. He spent 2 terms in Congress. He's an advocate for the Albanian American cause. He's worked with me for many years. He's very passionate about health care himself.
If you see something come up there, let me know.
His name is Congressman Joseph. If I can give him a few words about our kind of Congress, give Joe a hand.
Hello. You know, this mic is kind of funny. Can you hear me without the mic?
No.
neither am I. Okay, let me just...
Now, I am recording. I got you, Gaz. I got you recorded on my little... Can you imagine that little camera?
Takes 6 hours to film on a little flash card. It's unbelievable. But am I centered properly? Can you see me?
You're centered.